Good morning, church. Welcome back to online service. We're glad that you could join us this week. We want you to know that we love you, we're praying for you, and we want you to join in worship with us.
There is a sound I love to hear. It's the sound of the Savior's robe as he walks into the room where people pray, where we hear praises. He
Hey, good morning. Another Sunday morning, or as I like to call it, Resurrection Sunday reminder. The early church had church on a Sunday morning after Jesus' resurrection. It was a constant reminder that he was alive, that he was who he said he is. That's why 2,000 years later, we are still worshiping Jesus. He conquered, the Bible says, death, hell, and the grave. So I want you to know that the word eternal life literally means to live in perfection without end. So it's not just life, there's a quality of life. And that's why Jesus came. I just did a series called Abundant Life, and it's really about the quality of life that God wanted us to have. So this morning, I just want to welcome you. I just want to thank you for tuning in, for watching these messages. They mean the world to us. I know I've said that a gazillion times, but we really do mean it. And we would love your feedback if you want to, send us feedback. We have a website, ktf.org. You can hit the bell. You can subscribe. You can do all those crazy things. And if you need help, you can go to our website. There's a way to email us, and we will get back to you. We are in the business of helping people. Jesus said, I'm about my Father's business, and Jesus' business was helping people, so we want to help you. Again, we deeply appreciate your support. I wish I could say that it's churches run on air, but they do need your support. They do need your contributions. It's a very wonderful thing to be able to have people help you communicate the gospel of Jesus Christ to the world. We are partners. We are partners. As God has partnered with the church, so you are partnering with God's plan and purpose for the world, which is the church. That's us. So we love you very much. I have always found Jesus to be an incredibly interesting person, and we're about to read a passage of scripture that in my mind just makes Jesus even more interesting, because it is a perspective and a point of view that the Bible talked about a couple of thousand years before he came. And again, Jesus is fulfilling a prophecy, which is another way of saying it's proof that the Bible is true. You can't predict something thousands of years ahead of time and see them come to pass almost word for word, except I guess you're God and you have a plan and purpose, and you're trying to communicate your plan and purposes to the world. So one of the ways that God does it is through prophecy, telling us what's coming. And it all of the prophecies are really pointing to a single person. So for 1,000 years, God's been talking about a single person, which is Jesus. And it's so amazing, because every prophecy just fits him. I mean, like a tailor puts a perfectly fitted shirt or perfectly fitted suit on somebody. They perfectly fit him. He fulfilled these prophecies, which is one of the reasons why we have a faith in him. God had such a purpose in Jesus Christ that he predicted he's coming, he's coming, he's coming, he's coming. And then when he was on the scene, he said, it's fulfilled, it's fulfilled, it's fulfilled, it's fulfilled. So that we would have confidence and we would have faith, not only that God's word is his word, that it's untainted and untouched by human imagination and human corruption, but it was recorded as God wanted it recorded through human vessels who are not perfect, but God is perfect. So his message has come to us, and it is very, very powerful. And his message is always about Jesus. So we're going to read this amazing passage of scripture. After saying all of this, Jesus headed straight for Jerusalem. And when he arrived at the stables of Anaya near the Mount of Olives, he sent two of his disciples ahead, saying, when you enter the next village, you'll find tethered there a donkey's young colt that has never been ridden. Untie it and bring it to me. And if anyone stops you, ask, what are you doing? Just tell them this: it is needed for the Lord. So I'm imagining your car is parked on the side of the road and somebody comes, God needs your car, and they borrow it. In those days, it's a pretty big miracle. It's a pretty big miracle. But again, we're going to learn something about that miracle in a couple of minutes. So just tell them it's needed by the Lord. The two disciples entered the village and found the colt exactly like Jesus had said. So here's Jesus himself with a tremendous powers. While they were untying it, the owner confronted them and said, what are you doing? The disciples replied, we need this donkey for the Lord. So we need your car. It was a big deal in those days. It was like their pickup truck, you know. They needed it for work. They needed it for transportation. It was just amazing. And after they brought the colt to Jesus, they placed their prayer shawls on its back, and Jesus rode it as he descended the Mount of Olives toward Jerusalem. And he rode toward the city. People spontaneously threw their prayer shawls like carpets, their clothes up, and like a carpet on the path in front of them. As soon as he got to the bottom of the Mount of Olives, the crowd of his followers shouted out with loud outbursts of ecstatic joy over all the mighty wonders of power they had witnessed. They shouted over and over, highest praises to God for the one who comes as King. The name of my message is, the King has come. In the name of the Lord of heaven, peace and glory from the highest realms of heaven has now come to us. Isn't that beautiful? Heaven wants to come to you. Wherever you are, heaven wants to visit you. Is your heart open? Are you ready for a visitation of heaven? And if it came, would you receive it? Today, there's so much opposition to what is the morality of God, the goodness of God, the truth of God. It's just, there's just so much opposition. I wonder if Jesus came today, if we would crucify him all over again. I think we might even crucify him after he came the first time and knowing who he is, because we're just so opposed to what Jesus is preaching and he's teaching. But the world was never the same after he came. And I don't mean it was never the same for the worst. It was never the same for the better. Lives have been transformed and changed. The whole Bible is about transformed lives for the better. You don't see people becoming better criminals, bigger murderers. I don't know if I'm saying the English right. Or greater adulterers, or liars, or cheats, their lives are transformed. Something good has happened because the God of the Bible is good. So, teacher, order your father. So, some Jewish religious leaders who stood off from the procession said to Jesus, teacher, order your followers at once to stop saying these things. And just Jesus responded to them, listen to me, if my followers were silenced, the very stones would break forth with praises. You know, Jesus being again himself a prophet, the Bible teaches that he is the foundation, and we, the people, are like living stones built to be a habitation for God, a house for God's presence to dwell in. It's beautiful. God doesn't want a temple made out of stone and brick and wood. He wants a temple in our hearts. The altar is our hearts, and when we're gathered together, right, it's a big altar, and it's a big temple. And so, you know, again, Jesus' words foreseeing the future that there would be a church of living stones in which his spirit would inhabit. Just really, really beautiful. So he's saying something to them that's so far beyond their mind. You know, that's what Jesus does. Jesus is always blowing our minds. And it's just amazing. He's a mind-blowing Jesus. So he's telling them about a future that is coming with living stones who are going to praise him. So I just want to give you three things. Foretaste, freedom, and future. Foretaste, freedom, and future. So Jesus came to give us a foretaste of his coming kingdom. He restored lives to God's will, giving them a freedom from sin, from suffering, and from lack. I mean, he fed the 5,000, he healed their sick, he forgave their sins. I mean, he's just, oh wow. It's just incredible, the authority and the power that Jesus has. Can I tell you something? I don't know what religion you belong to. The religious leaders were complaining about Jesus because he gives us forgiveness without religious duties, without religious works. The thief on the cross next to him could not earn a single day of salvation. In fact, he earned that death on the cross and he earned spiritual death, but Jesus instantly forgave him. So the Christian faith is not about religious works. In fact, the Bible said that after we're saved, we do good works, because before, we cannot earn salvation from a perfectly holy God. There's no amount of works that we can do to offset the evil that's in our nature, in our lives, and that's in our hearts, our imaginations. So forgiveness comes straight from Jesus. It does not come by human effort. And so 90% of the world's religions are effort. Christianity is completely the opposite. It's not by human effort, but as we come to Christ, he forgives us and he empowers us. We are powerless to do it before. You've heard me preach a few times. Try and stop doing a particular thing that's wrong. You can't, because but when Jesus comes into your life, like I said, we see all these transformed lives. When Jesus came, people's lives were made better. not worse. So it was a foretaste of his coming kingdom. Not only would it be a kingdom of holiness, where sin would not reign, which means we wouldn't do evil to one another, we wouldn't destroy the world and the purposes and plans of God. It was just a foretaste. And every evil that was done, as Jesus touched people, spoke over them, healed them, and delivered them, everything was reversed. I preached a message one time called Reverse the Curse. So he reversed the effects of sin in every life that he touched, and he wants to do that for you, and he wants to do that for I. So I call that freedom. It was freedom. He gave us freedom from the past, freedom from effects, no shame, no guilt. We are completely forgiven, and now we are able to receive all that God has for us. Freedom from sin, suffering, and lack. Anything you lack, there's freedom from lack. That's such a powerful thing. A freedom from lack. Whatever you lack, God will supply. Apostle Paul said it this way: my God shall supply all of your needs according to his riches in glory. So he came to the end of evil. He came to end the reign of evil. It's such a powerful thing. God's provision for a broken world was profuse in Jesus because he loves us. I love that. He came to give us a promise and a future. So Jesus, you know, all this stuff was a foretaste. It was a present freedom, but there's coming a glory where there's going to be no evil in the world. He's going to conquer it. And the kingdoms of this world have become the kingdoms of his Christ, and he shall reign forever and ever. There'll be no evil in the world. So he's come not only to forgive us now, but to give us an eternal future where death does not exist, where you are alive, even though you may have died while you were here on earth. You will be resurrected physically and spiritually to live forever in the presence of God. Jesus came to also reverse death. And that's as we're getting towards Good Friday and Easter, let's catch a glimpse of that. It's a foretaste. He rose Lazarus from the dead. He rose a young girl that had died from the dead. You know, we find Jesus very, very powerful, saying, I am the resurrection and the life. So though we are dead, he is the resurrection and the life. Though every one of us will die, one day he will resurrect us, our physical bodies, as he's already resurrected, if you believe in him, our spiritual man, to be connected with God so that we can be whole in heaven, spirit, soul, and body, in the presence of God forever. So if we receive him as king, the king is come. If we will receive him as king, he will offer us a pardon, a forgiveness of sins, to walk in the favor as children of God, of the kingdom. Children of the kingdom. I am a child of the kingdom. An eternal victory over death. Foretaste. They made him king because he delivered them, loved them, and provided for them. I mean, boy, that's kind of Jesus in a nutshell. They made him king because he delivered them. He delivered them from fear, from worry, from oppression, even from fate. You know, those people in those days, they didn't have doctors. They didn't have hospitals. They didn't have nurses. They didn't have medicines like we had. I mean, they were just at the mercy of fate. And so many places Jesus went, there's a beautiful picture of a man who had been trying to get into a pool to be healed, and he was there many, many years. You just read so many stories of people infirm for many, 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 many years, but Jesus came. He delivered them. It's so beautiful. Why? Because he loved them, and he provided for them. God, if he's not provision, he's not anything. God, he may be holy, and some people just see him as stern. Holiness doesn't mean stern. It means profuse love, and that means stopping all evil and harm to the people that you love. But he's also a provider. In fact, one of the first names he gives the people of Israel in the Old Testament is Jehovah Jireh, the Lord who provides. So the people were celebrating him because they heard his words and saw his miracles. Jesus preached what they were experiencing is only the beginning. It just gets better when you receive Jesus. You know, so many people have prayed that prayer with me. Listen to me, follow up. I bet you're going to have breakfast today. I bet if you don't have breakfast, you're going to have lunch. I bet you don't have lunch, you're going to have dinner. I bet sometime today you're going to have something to eat. Why? Why are you going to do that? Because you have to feed your body to stay alive. Why do we go to church? Why do we read the word? We have to feed our spirit to stay alive, and it's beautiful. So keep feeding your spirit. They saw the word, they heard the miracles. But what they was experiencing was only the beginning. Church, it's only the beginning. Keep feeding your spirit. Your spirit gets fed so it can have faith. If it doesn't, its faith will starve. You don't want your faith to starve. Jesus, we read that he fed the 5,000, you know, but it was a sign of feeding your spirit. If you feed your spirit, you come alive. Feed your spirit. You'll be strong and healthy. Feed your spirit. So he delivered them from sin and suffering. The closer they came to Jesus, the greater the miracles they received. So, you know, in fact, there's a woman in the Bible. She was bleeding her whole life, you know, and she just touched the hem of his garment, you know, and you know, she was so afraid because there was a crowd and she was considered unclean. Listen, we're all unclean. But the thing is, when we touch Jesus, we're not only made whole, but we're made clean. As soon as she drew near and she touched him, she was made whole. So I want to encourage you this morning as you hear this message, maybe just close your eyes and say, Jesus, I'm just reaching out to you to touch you. And touch the places in my life that are not clean. Touch the places in my life that are broken, that need healing. Touch the places in my life. But I want to draw near Jesus. So the Bible teaches he can be touched by our weaknesses and sufferings. The Bible said in Hebrews, we have a great high priest. A high priest was someone who brought an offering to God first. He prepared the offering. He removed the obstacle of sin and separation from God by that offering. Jesus was that high priest. He offered himself. So the obstacle of approaching God and coming to God and getting what you needed was removed. He did it on the cross. He removed every obstacle to drawing near to God. And the Bible said he did it because he was a high priest who could be touched by our infirmities, our sicknesses, our weaknesses. So, you know, the Bible teaches us that this is Jesus. That's why he became human. That's why he became flesh. In fact, the Bible said Jesus, who's God, learned what it meant to live in human flesh. He learned obedience. You know, he was never in that condition, never in that place, never felt tired, never felt weak, never felt lonely, but he was in the place of a human being so he could understand, and he understood fully, and he can be touched. We read over and over again, he was moved with compassion and he healed them. One place it says, and he healed them all. It's very powerful. To those who would listen and believe, he gave them a mighty foretaste of the coming kingdom. He gave them faith in a good father who was with them and had not forgotten them. These people felt abandoned. So many prophecies, they had been waiting and waiting and waiting. When is Jesus coming? You know, they had access to God the whole time, but they didn't see the way to God. When Jesus came, he was really visible. He became man. He said, God's right here in front of you as a man, so I'm approachable, so you can touch me. I love it. He gave them faith in a good father who was with them and had not forgotten them. He gave them what no earthly kingdom or ruler could give them, new lives and renew their hope. Boy, after these people, they were throwing everything they can down because they had renewed lives and renewed hope. He was talking about his kingdom fully coming into the world. He taught it first has to come fully into your heart before it can come into your life. I like that point. Good preaching, Pastor Sal. Love you guys. Freedom. He brought them the good news of the kingdom. That was freedom. Good news. The kingdom is here. Good news. The people lived under terrible oppression from rulers and the religious leaders. They were taxed, mocked, condemned, used by those in power. Many struggled with poverty and sickness. Well, we might think he was the king of only the poor and the oppressed. You would be wrong. Nicodemus, a religious ruler, neither knew God or his will. Came to Jesus in the middle of the night. The rich young ruler in his arrogance told Jesus the perfect sinless sacrifice, that he was perfect. He fulfilled all the law. It's amazing. Oh my God. Matthew, a wealthy tax collector who cheated his own people, turned to Jesus for forgiveness. So it wasn't just for the poor and the marginalized. It was for everyone. A centurion servant. I mean, this is a guy from the Roman government. His servant was healed when he put his faith in Jesus. If we think the kingdom is only about material things that perish, can be lost or taken away, then we know nothing about Jesus. He promised a security in him as God, security in him as God, that no earthly king could promise. He promised a future a beginning now and a hope for all eternity. So he promised a future beginning now and a hope for all eternity. You see, the one thing missing in all these people's lives was they did not know God, his mercy, his love, and his promises to forgive us. They had not experienced his power and faithfulness to always keep those promises to those who believe. If you're a believer, he's going to keep those promises to you. He promised to be near them in their hour of greatest need. It says in Psalms, he's a very present help in time of need. He made it evident that spiritual poverty was in both the rich and the poor, the sick and healthy, and let's just say this, the powerful and the powerless. So he is the first and only king to offer forgiveness and entrance into the kingdom. The first and only. Come on, say with me, the first and only. Preach with me. Come on, the first and only. The last one, a future. He showed them his sovereign and tenacious love. I love this about Jesus. So the miracle of the colt is kind of like really weird, right? In the middle of this story, there's this colt that Jesus needs. He's fulfilling a prophecy now because in Isaiah he said this king is going to come riding in on a colt and they're going to throw palms and their garments before him. And, you know, so he's going to fulfill this prophecy. So the miracle of the colt is to see a God whose sovereign will. So nothing's going to thwart God. Nothing's going to thwart God from calling a people to himself, from saving people, from loving people, from delivering people, from forgiving people. So we see his sovereign will. This is his will. It's unchangeable. Sovereign means unchangeable. He's never going to change his mind. He wants to love. He wants to save. He wants to deliver. He wants to rescue. He wants to prosper. He wants to bless. This is who he is. It's his sovereign will. This is who he is. His sovereign will, power, and love will move heaven and earth to reach you. This little miracle about a guy saying yes about his donkey is just showing the power of God to arrange things, to get to you. It is seeing God has arranged everything to come to you. God is arranging your life right now to come to you in this broadcast even. He would come as king and would not be late. Oh my God, God is never late. I don't know what your problem is, your circumstance is, whatever it is in your life, he's not late. Today, the Bible said, is the acceptable time. Today is your day. He came fulfilling prophecy, reminder he has come to keep his word to those who call upon him. Powerful thing. Are you ready to receive him and all he has for you? Come on, he's got a lot. It was only the beginning. The thing that is tragic is God made a way to the people of this world miraculously. That's what that little donkey story is about. He's come miraculously. He came through a virgin birth, and in his own incarnation, he became one of us so we could know him and embrace him. How many people, with all the miracles he did, fail to recognize him? I believe God has done some miracles in your life, and you fail to recognize it was God, or you fail to recognize that it was God at all. Some will never know God has been in their life. Some people are just so oblivious to the goodness of God, they will never know that God has been reaching out to them for years. This is a tragedy. It's just a tragedy. Some will never know the miracles before them was a sign showing them the way back to God. So many who rejected his words will never find their way to God in eternal life. So many are oblivious to the king before them, the love that beats for them, the truth that will set them free. So many people are oblivious to the king before them, the love that beats in his heart for you, and the power to set you free. Wow, many are blinded because they care so little for the things that matter to God. Holy mackerel, our opinions just keep us from God. It just keeps on rolling, doesn't it? We just live like crazy people. The king has made his way to you. Will you receive him today? Mercy has come in a king. Grace has come in a king. Help has come in a king. Favor has come in a king. All we have to do is receive him as our king. His kingdom is freely given. Jesus is the king of hearts. Jesus is the king of hearts. Many did not receive the power of his words. They not only rejected his teaching because of the hardness of their hearts, they denied the miracles right before their eyes. They did not see he was king in disguise, looking for genuine seekers. Why did he say a parable? Why does he have to be invisible? Why doesn't he just show up? Why, if he just did this, if he just did that? God, if you just jump through my hoops, I'll believe. You know, because faith has to see God where he is, not where you want him. That's what faith is about. Faith is recognizing God. He's the God in your midst. So many people don't even recognize it because they're just so far from knowing God and what God is about. It's just amazing. But to those who recognize him, they threw down their filthy clothes, covering their sinful lives for a robe of righteousness. Beautiful. They threw their clothes before them. The Bible says that when we give our lives to Jesus, he takes our filthy garments of sin and puts his own robe on us. It was beautiful. One time I was in this city and there was a homeless man and he didn't have a jacket, and I saw this Christian man walk over and put his beautiful new clean jacket around and took off his old jacket, threw it in the trash. Beautiful picture. They offered him, you ready for this? The surrender of praise and obedience when they threw their palms that they let. It's a sign, it's significant. As they surrendered their lives, they were throwing down before him the praise and obedience to walk with him. I love it. He came to give us abundant life. Will you recognize him? Do you know why he came? To give us that abundant life. Imagine for a moment sitting on a hillside with Jesus, hearing his graceful words. Imagine his invitation to come and enter the kingdom. What will you do today? What will you do today? Can we pray together? What are you going to do about Jesus today? What are you going to do about this graciousness, this kindness, this King of mercy, this King of grace, this King of freedom, this King who loves you, this King who came, the King who left his kingdom to save his own people, to restore their citizenship to heaven, to bring forgiveness from heaven, that they could enter through him, as I preached last week, in abundant life, that he was the gate to the sheepfold. If you want this King, surrender your lives. Let him change your filthy clothes of sin for his beautiful robe of righteousness. Throw down your life in surrender. It's really just about, it's not religious works, it's not duties. It's surrendering to him so he could do the work for you and in you. Man, those are two powerful words. For and in, for and in, for and in, for and in, for you and in you. Pray this with me. Say, Jesus, I come to you. Be my Lord. I surrender my life to you. Do your work for me and in me. Come on, that I might be forgiven. In Jesus' name. Jesus, be my King. Do that work for me and in me, that I might be forgiven. In Jesus' name. Amen. Hey, thank you for tuning in. Palm Sunday. What an amazing day. I pray that you and your family and your friends and your neighbors would celebrate the King today. God bless you. We love you. We'll talk to you soon.
There is a sound I love to hear. It's the sound of the Savior's room as he walks into the room where people pray, where we hear praises. He hears faith. It's time to worship him.